Good morning. Welcome to worship here at Woodland United Methodist Church. We're excited about experiencing worship together. As you know, today's the day that we offer the opportunity of in-person worship or to continue with the online virtual worship. But we are starting some new things, and if you feel comfortable, we invite you to come on out to our in-person worships next Sunday. But right now, let's prepare ourselves and let God lead us as we worship God together and listen to our prelude.
Please join us for the hymn of praise, "My Life is in You, Lord." The Old Testament reading for today comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings. With two they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet. And with the two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The pivots on the threshold shook at the voices of those who called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me! I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips and live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here I am, send me." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
And now we come to our time of prayer. We'll begin with our congregational prayer. Let us pray. God, like a baker, you bring the leaven which causes our hopes to rise. With your strong and gentle hands, shape our lives. Warm us with your love. Take our common lives and touch them with your grace, that we may nourish your hope among all people. We offer this prayer today, trusting in the leading of your Holy Spirit, right here, right now, and forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord, our Savior, our most intimate and ever-present friend. O gracious Lord, as you take hold of us, let us listen. Let us let you transform us. Let us let you remake us, remold us into your image. Let us be willing to hear your voice so clearly that we're ready to go out and carry out your will in the world as we prepare ourselves to be that instrument of grace for you. So Lord, fill us with your Spirit. Fill us with your presence. Overwhelm us with your love. And let us be ready, Lord, to be your instrument of grace. And Lord, as we thank you for what you're doing for us right now at this moment, we thank you for what you're doing for others. We lift up as we reach, lift up those who need a special touch upon their bodies, their minds, and their spirits. We thank you that even now, Lord, they begin to feel the power of this prayer. They begin to notice something happening. They begin to feel more confident, more assured. They begin to feel the peace that they didn't feel just a few moments ago. They begin to feel the hope that you put in their hearts. And they begin to understand the love that's being offered to them through those angels, those caregivers, those doctors, all those instruments of grace that you're sending to them. They begin to notice you in them, and they will be able to relax, Lord, in your arms and let your work be done. We thank you for the power of prayer that we participate in your will and your purpose for the other people's lives. And Lord, we thank you. And we thank you, Lord, that you lift us up to be an instrument of that grace as we go to those, as we call those in need, and we let them know that we're thinking about them, we're praying for them, and we begin to give through our gentle words and our comforting spirit, we begin to give your presence, offer your presence to them through us as we go in your name. And Lord, we thank you that we can testify to who we are, that we are the family of God, the people of God, the children of God, the very body of Christ here at Woodland. As we prepare ourselves, Lord, to be that body in service and love. And we testify to our oneness, Lord, in this prayer. We testify, Lord Jesus, to our oneness with you as your followers and as your children and as your brothers and sisters. And we thank you, Lord, that we can testify by sharing together, Lord, in the very prayer that you, Lord Jesus, taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning. Today I want to talk with you a little bit about forgiveness. There is a story in the Bible that Pastor Michael's about to read for us, coming from Luke chapter 7, where Jesus was invited to the house of Simon for a party. Now, Simon knew all about Jesus. He knew about all the miraculous things that he'd done. And Simon probably had an ulterior motive for inviting Jesus to the party. See, he wanted to look important. He wanted others to see that he could be friends with this man that was reaching so many people. And while they were having dinner at this party, this woman came in who had not been invited to the party. She wanted to see Jesus because she too had heard about all the wonderful things he'd done. But this woman had a bad reputation. She had done lots of things wrong. She was a sinner. And Simon didn't want her there. But yet this woman came in, and she went up to Jesus and she poured perfume on his feet and cleaned them with her hair. Of course, everybody's just outraged. Like, why is she doing this? Why would she clean my feet? And Jesus looked at her and he said, "Woman, your sins have been forgiven." See, Jesus explained to Simon and all the other guests that she really, really loved me. She truly loved me. She knows what she's done wrong, and I've forgiven her. She showed how much she loved me by washing my feet with her hair. See, no matter what we do, if we really, truly know that we have done something wrong and go to Jesus in prayer and talk to him about it, he'll forgive us because he loves us. Don't be like Simon and be a little bit snobbish and do things just because you want people to notice you. But be like that woman who knelt down at Jesus' feet and Jesus was able to forgive her because he loved her. God, thank you that you do forgive our sins many, many, many times over if we truly confess and if we truly love you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Hey guys, I'm really excited to say that our 2020 pumpkin patch is right around the corner, and that means today we're starting our signups. So if you're interested in volunteering at the pumpkin patch, it's a great opportunity to reach out into the community and be the face of our church. I always like to say that this isn't just a fundraiser for youth missions, it's also a ministry of our church because we reach so many people in the community. Even though they may not come through the doors of this church, they can be graced and feel God's love by our interactions on the pumpkin patch. We'll be working shifts from September 27th all the way to October 31st, and we have more shifts than we've ever had in our 28-year history this year. So we're gonna need your help. So please be sure to go to the web address below or to the QR code and sign up today for your pumpkin patch shift. Thanks.
And now we come to this time of bringing our tithes and offerings to our Lord. Let's prepare our hearts as we prepare to bring our best offering to God, that this church may be able to reach out into our community and beyond with the gospel and the love of Jesus. There are several ways you can give as you bring your tithes and offerings. You can give online. You can call the church office and someone will be glad to come by and pick up your offering. You can mail it in to the church, or you can follow the text message on the screen. So let's prepare ourselves now and bring our tithes and offerings. Thank you. Let us pray. Our gracious Lord, we thank you. We ask your blessing upon the gifts. We ask your blessing upon the givers. We thank you, Lord, and ask your blessing upon our church as we continue to minister in your name. We ask your blessing in all these things in thy precious name of Jesus. Amen. And now we come to the reading from our gospel, Luke chapter 7, verses 36 through 50. Now one of the Pharisees invited Jesus to have dinner with him. So he went to the Pharisee's house and reclined at the table. When a woman in that town learned that Jesus was eating at the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster jar of perfume, and as she stood behind him at his feet weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears. Then she wiped them with her hair, kissed them, and poured perfume on them. When the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would know who is touching him and what kind of woman she is, that she is a sinner." Jesus answered him, "Simon, I have something to tell you." "Tell me, teacher," he said. "Two men owed money to a certain moneylender. One owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back, so he canceled the debts of both. Now, which of them will love him more?" Simon replied, "I suppose the one who had the bigger debt canceled." "You have judged correctly," Jesus said. Then he turned toward the woman and said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman from the time I entered has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, for she loved much. But he who has been forgiven little loves little." Then Jesus said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." The other guests began to say among themselves, "What is this, or who is this, even to forgive sins?" Jesus said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Please join us for the hymn of faith, "Leave It There."
You have to get along with me, girl.
And now as we look at this scripture, it's an interesting story. And every time I've read this story in the past, I've always been fascinated by it, about this woman going to Jesus when he went to stay at the Pharisee's house for a while to have dinner with him. The reason this story is fascinating is because this woman, just hearing that he was there, decides to rush to the house to be with him. There's some things that I have misunderstood about this story, and I realize that now. And that is the fact that she wasn't running there because she wanted anything from Jesus. You know, we often think that we have to run to Jesus and tell him, "I'm so sorry, Jesus, I've been so bad, and I've done things I know I shouldn't have done, or I know there are things you think I shouldn't have done, and I'm sorry, and I want you to forgive me for all of this, and I'm just begging you to do that." But that's not what this story is about. And though we often will look at it that way and try to put it as a woman who's repentant, comes to Jesus asking for his forgiveness, and he forgives us. But that's not it. She doesn't ask him for anything. If you look at the story, when she hears Jesus is at the Pharisee's house, she immediately jumps up and runs. Now, how in the world did she expect to get in the Pharisee's house? How did she expect? Everyone in the town knew about her. Everyone looked down on her. Everybody thought of her as a terrible sinner and someone that would make them unclean if they were around her. You remember the story of the Good Samaritan. In the Good Samaritan story, when the man falls into the ditch, is beaten up and left in the ditch, half dead and unconscious and naked because they stripped his clothes off of him, and dirty, that people walking by, the religious people who came by, looked and saw someone in that ditch, and they decided to go on the other side of the road because the law said, the spiritual law said, that if you touched anything unclean, you became unclean. And they didn't know anything about this person, and so they had to go on the other side to protect themselves. Because if they became unclean, it was a long process they'd have to go through. They'd have to quarantine, which everyone understands. They would have had to quarantine for so long before they could ever be around people again because they'd been near someone who was declared unclean. And of course, in that story, we understand that the reason everything happened the way it did in Jesus' story of the Good Samaritan was because he wanted to make sure that no one knew or had any idea who this was. Do you care for the least of these? Do you care for the person you don't know anything about? Because he had him naked, he had him dirty, he had him, so you couldn't look at him and know him by his clothes, you couldn't know him by the skin color, you couldn't notice anything, and you couldn't even notice by his accent because he's unconscious. So they decided to go on the other side, but then the Samaritan comes along and has compassion. And then it doesn't matter all those things. He sees the man hurting. He actually sees him as he really is and wants to help him because he would want people to do that for him, and he wants to do it for him. Well, in this story, this woman jumps up and she runs. She has no idea whether she'll get to see him. She has no idea if anybody might be at the door. She doesn't think. You know, sometimes we think too much about whether we should or shouldn't. We think too much about whether or not this is good for us or not good for us to react this way or do this or to care for this person. Maybe this won't be good for us. Maybe we shouldn't. Maybe they won't understand. Maybe they won't listen to us. So we try to think of reasons not to do. But sometimes we've just got to jump up and go because we feel in our hearts it's something we have to do. And we run without thinking. And she didn't think about how she was going to get in there, but she ran there and she got in there. She ran past everyone. She ran right to Jesus. And she knew him. And she fell at his feet. Now, why did she do that? Because he had already blessed her. She did that because he had already touched her life. He had already changed her. Because when he looked at her, he saw something that no one else saw. And she knew that. He also saw something that she had forgotten about or didn't see anymore. You know, when people put other people down, when they insult people, when they say negative things about people, at some point, those people often begin to believe what they're hearing. And they begin to believe those things about themselves. So they become upset. They become sad. They become depressed. They begin to think they're just no good. And they begin to act like they're no good. I might as well go ahead and do these things I've been doing because it doesn't matter. Nothing I do will ever be good to anyone around me. They all see me as someone evil. They don't see me. They just see an evil person. But when Jesus looked at her, she was saying, he saw me, and he saw me in ways that I didn't see me. And suddenly I knew I could be someone else. I could rise up. I could overcome. In fact, I knew that God would not hold anything that was back there from over me. He would lead me to something up there, forward, something new, something wonderful, that everything could be forgiven. He has forgiven me. And she knew that just by having been around him and seeing it in his eyes as he looked at her and cared for her. So when she heard he was at this house, she wasn't running to him hoping that he would be good to her and love her and maybe forgive her. She ran to him because she knew this was a man who already had forgiven, already was loving, already was caring, already was treating her as someone who mattered. So she runs to the house, falls at Jesus' feet, begins to cry. She's crying. Understand, once again, this is not crying because she's upset about her life or she's upset about who she is. She's crying of joy because Jesus has treated her different from anyone else. That Jesus had loved her when no one else did. That Jesus was not passing judgment and attacking and condemning her because of things he'd heard and everyone in the town, all the gossip that was going on in the town. He didn't judge her for that. He looked at her deep into her soul and he loved her and he saw her as one of his. He saw her as someone who needed him. He saw her as someone who just needed to be lifted up and given the possibility, given the chance to rise up and become new and different. So he saw that in her. So when she fell and cried, she was crying these tears of joy because she was with the one man who cared and who understood and who loved and was reaching out for her. And so she fell at his feet. And as she was crying, and she began to anoint his feet with perfume. Understand, once again, people will say, well, you know, she must have been planning this because she brought perfumes. Or she must have had all this planned out that someday she was going to go and do this for him. And all this was some kind of plan to go and put perfume on him and then to beg him for something. But even that part she would have had with her anyway. It doesn't say she ran from her home. It says she ran to him, to this home where he was. But the perfume part was something that people carried with, the women especially, carried with them all the time because they didn't have access, especially the poor people, didn't have access to take baths every day or every week and sometimes even longer, every month. And then so they didn't get the opportunity, so they would get dirty or they'd have to just wash off best they could, but they couldn't get really the clean physically that they wanted to get. So they carried this perfume so they could anoint themselves with the perfume and they would be able to have a decent smell about them and they would be able to continue doing what they're doing. Even if they're doing things that they can't do better or they're doing things that aren't quite right in society, but the fact is society won't let them into their little club so they can try to do things that are right to make it through their life. Anyway, she brought that, she anointed his feet, she kissed his feet, and she did all of that. And then Jesus is sitting there, letting her do all of this. And then the Pharisee is perturbed by it, and he says, oh my goodness, look at this sinful woman. Everybody knows what she is, and she's here doing this to Jesus. Obviously, Jesus can't be much of a prophet, because prophets are supposed to know stuff about people. And, of course, Jesus didn't know. That was what made this miraculous and made this amazing. But they're supposed to know these things. So if he knew who this woman was, he wouldn't let her touch him because he didn't want to be unclean. She's unclean. And he wouldn't let her do all of this that she was doing if he knew who she was, that she's a sinner. She's a sinner. And Jesus, once again, knowing what people are thinking, knowing what's in their heart, knowing who they are, said to Simon the Pharisee, Simon, I've got something to tell you. And then Simon says, go ahead, teach me, Lord, teach me, Lord. And so he tells him about a man who has two debtors, two people who owe him money, and one of them owes him a lot, and one owes him a little. And he says, and he realized both of them could not pay him back. They didn't have the money to pay him back. And he decided, out of the generosity of his heart, to pardon them and to excuse them of their debts, both of them. And he said, which of them do you think will care more about the one who forgave their debt. And he said the one who, I guess, loved him most would be the one who was forgiven the most. And Jesus said, you're right, you're right. He said, now look at this. I've been in your house, and I come in off the dirty, dusty street, and you didn't give me any water for my feet, to clean my feet. You didn't kiss me, give me a kiss, a greeting kiss, welcome into my home. You didn't do any of these things for me, and yet here's this woman, and she's fallen down at my feet. She's kissed my feet, and she has cleaned my feet. She wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair, and she's anointed my feet with perfume. She's done all these wonderful things for me, and her sins, which are many, of course, we all have sin, they're forgiven. And then when he said that, he looked at the woman, and he said, your sins are forgiven. And the people around said, how in the world can this man forgive sins? Who is he? And then he tells her, her faith has made her saved. Her faith has saved her. Her trust in him has saved her, he said. Now, you got to understand something else about what happened in this story. When he turned to Simon and said, Simon, this woman, he begins first by saying, do you see her, Simon? Do you see this woman? Ah, Simon's never saw this woman. He saw someone he had heard was a terrible, rotten sinner, someone that needs to be shunned and pushed aside, someone who deserves punishment, someone who is unworthy, someone who has brought all their problems on herself, as many people will say even today about people who are suffering, who are poor, and who are hurting. And then he said, that's what he saw. But then Jesus said, do you see her, Simon? Do you see her? And then he talked about this love that she was showing. You see, she came there because she had been blessed. She came there because Jesus had taken hold of her. She came there because she knew that Jesus looked at her and saw something better, something good, something worthy, something of God. He saw her as someone who was equally loved by God as anyone else. And because she knew that she had strayed from God in many ways, but here's Jesus saying, come home, come to me. You are my child. You're of my family. Come to me. Let me have you. Let me be with you. I want you to know I believe in you. And I know what's going on in your heart. I know what led you to this place. I know that people have treated you so badly. I know you struggled just to survive on the street because no one would help you. And I know that because you had to go through all of this, you made some decisions that maybe the world is saying you should never have made. But you were trying to take care and to keep yourself alive. And there may have been others that you were trying to help as well. So you're trying to take care of them as well, to keep them safe and well. And so you're doing the best you can. And sometimes you may do things that you know you shouldn't. And now you realize that you shouldn't have, but you just found yourself so lost you didn't know what to do. I'm here to tell you that you're not lost anymore. I've got you. You're with me. And I will make sure that everyone I know and everyone who comes to me and everyone who walks in my footsteps, everyone who becomes a Christian, if the Christian church becomes the Christian church, if it becomes disciples of Christ, becomes the children of God, if we do that, then Jesus should be able to say to that woman, there's going to be a tremendous group that's going to rise up out of me, my family, my children, the church of the living God, and those people will never treat you the way the people in the world are treating you. They won't treat you that way because they're my family. They're my followers. They follow my example. They won't. You'll have a whole church caring for you and wanting to help you and believing in what you could be and not judging you by what you have been. Imagine if the church lived up to what Jesus sees as the church. What if we became those instruments of grace to the world and that people begin to look at us and see him? I say so often about the church that if we want people to come in here If we go out there to try to reach people and we want them to come in here, then the people in here have to be so different from those out there. Because if we're no different, then why in the world should they want to come in here? They already got those kind of people if we're judging and condemning and pointing fingers. But if they want to come in here, because when they came to church and when we walk into sanctuary, we call it, that's exactly what it's supposed to be. A place where you feel safe and you feel loved and you feel accepted and you feel that you belong and you realize the church is not for those who are perfect. It's for sinners to come together and love one another and let Christ transform us. And then to go out and share with the world, there is a place where you will be loved for who you are, not for what you've done or what people say about you, but because you are a child of God. And you'll be able to accept that, not just what people think of you, but you'll begin to change how you think of yourself, and you will become a new person in Him. So the woman came to Him because she knew that He loved her. She knew that He saw her in a different way. And it changed everything for her. For the first time in her life, there was hope. For the first time in her life, she didn't have to live with the shame of what she had been. And she no longer had to live with the shame of what people were saying about her. She actually found someone who cared about her, who saw her for who she is. So often we have to look and see people for who they are. And when someone is hurting, I've said this so often when I've ridden by some checkout place, or gone by a checkout counter, or gone by a drive-through window or something, anywhere, and someone is rude to you, insulting to you, or just says things that are mean, and you start thinking, I want to talk to the manager, or I want to go and complain about this person. But how often do we look at them like Jesus does and we say, oh my goodness, something's going on in this person's life. There's something that's hurting them. And you try to see them as a hurting child, not as a rude, insulting person. And you try to find out. And sometimes when you ask them if they're okay, sometimes if you ask them, is there anything I can do? Because it looks like you're stressed. And sometimes they will realize what they've done and they will say, I'm sorry, you're right, I shouldn't have talked like that. And sometimes you'll discover that they have a sick relative or they have something going on in their life or they are trying to get this other job that will give them more hours or more money that they can take care of their family. They're doing something's going on in their life, and in that moment they just were not in the best of mood. But you see them. You don't see the things they've done. You see them as someone who matters, and you try to care for them. When we talk about in our days today with racial tension and all that, and we say that about people mattering, people of color mattering, that people matter, when we say that, we're saying that sometimes people are treated like they don't matter as much as others. That's when we have to stand up. Where this woman felt that she did not matter as the rest of the people in the community mattered. She didn't matter as much, and she began to believe it. She just didn't matter as much. And then Jesus smiled at her one day. Jesus looked at her one day. Jesus reached out to her one day, and He changed everything in her life. And she came to Him crying and thankful because suddenly she discovered for the first time that she mattered. And that she had a right to stand up with everyone else. Stand up in church with everyone else. Worship together with everyone else. That we're all brothers and sisters in Christ. We're the people of God. The children of God. The family of God. Brothers and sisters in Christ. We are the followers of Jesus. And we're all equal. Let us always love others as Jesus has loved us. And then we will be following His example in all things. Let's be the church of God and go forth in His name. Thank you. And now, as you go forth with Christ, but also Go forth as one who knows that you're a person of infinite worth, because Christ looks at you and sees you that way. He sees not what you are, but what you can be in Him. He sees you as the person that He created you as the beginning of time to be, that God had always intended you to be. Go forth and live a life that testifies to who Jesus believes that you are, that you walk in His footsteps and follow His example every moment of every day. In Jesus' name, go forth. Amen.